Good morning, children.
Good morning, ma'am.
We learned about biological magnification last class. One more slide is remaining. But before that, one of you tell me, what is the definition for biological magnification? There are different names, okay? We say it is biological magnification, biomagnification, bioaccumulation. So one of you tell me, Vishnupriya, give me the definition for biomagnification.
Progressive accumulation of non-biodegradable chemicals in living organism in a tissue.
Yes, good. So we say it is progressive accumulation. Why do we say it is progressive accumulation? Lalita, what do you mean by progressive accumulation? Or what she tried to say? Understood. Progressive accumulation.
In your words,
the harmful substances will keep on increasing. About energy, what did we learn? As it moves from one trophic level to the other. Mohammed Aman, what happens to the energy as it moves from the lower trophic level to the higher trophic level?
Multiply.
Yes? Doubles.
Multiplies by 10.
Multiplies. That is what he is saying. Somebody help me out, no?
Yes, ma'am.
You are not revising your daily lesson, Aman. Don't disappoint me like this. Somebody say the point. Who will tell? Fia?
Reduced.
Only 10%.
Means it will get reduced. Aman, the energy as it passes from the lower trophic level to the higher level, energy keeps on reducing. Only 10% of energy is getting transferred from one trophic level to the other. Whereas the chemical substances, the non-biodegradable substances, as it passes from the lower trophic level to the higher trophic level, it's not decreasing. Instead, it is increasing. It becomes more and more, and the maximum will be there. Maximum accumulation or maximum concentration of these chemical substances will be present in the highest trophic level. And in most of the food chains, human beings occupy the topmost level. So we are very badly affected by this biological magnification. And we already learned, I will show those slides once again. Okay, those who haven't understood, just go through the slides once again. And if anybody have missed out also, you can make use of this. It's a progressive accumulation of non-biodegradable chemicals. Non-biodegradable means chemicals which cannot be broken down by natural means or by microbial action, and they keep on accumulating progressively as it moves from the lowest trophic level to the highest. The level keeps on increasing, and here in the picture you can see in water, very negligible amount, ppm, parts per million, very less amount. But once it reaches fish-eating birds, so the highest trophic level, you can see 25 parts per million. From water, which was a very negligible percent or negligible parts per million, when it reached zooplankton. Zooplankton means the microscopic animals found in water body, 0.04. Then when it reached small fishes, it became 0.5. And in large fish, 2. And finally, in the highest trophic level, it increased to 25. So it will, even though energy keeps on reducing as it moves from one trophic level to the other, concentration of harmful chemicals will keep on increasing. Don't get confused between the accumulation of chemical substances and reduction in the energy. You should be thorough with that. It's a very important topic. And another definition for biological magnification is increase in the concentration of harmful chemicals in the body of living organism at successive trophic levels. As it proceeds from one trophic level to the other, amount of these chemicals also will keep on increasing. All these we had learned in our previous class. And several, now let's see how this biological magnification is happening. One example, you know that Nowadays, we are encouraged to carry out organic farming. What is organic farming, children? Any idea what is meant by organic farming?
Using modern methods.
Louder.
Using modern methods and tools.
Not modern. We can't say it is modern. Organic.
Ma'am, without any chemical.
Exactly. Without using any chemicals. Completely organic, completely natural substances, biopesticides, biofertilizers, no chemical substances or less amount of chemicals are being used in organic farming. Nowadays, we are encouraged to carry out, or farmers are also encouraged to carry out organic farming with less or no use of chemicals. And in hypermarkets and all, you can buy organic vegetables and organic fruits also, maybe a bit costly when compared to the other products available. And children, there are so many drawbacks for using chemicals. You know, it will cause water pollution, soil pollution, air pollution, and one among that is a major side effect of using these chemicals is that it will pollute all the organisms in the food chain. Now, several pesticides and other chemicals, you use them to protect the crops from diseases and pests. Several pesticides, so plants will get affected by pests. If pests are there, the productivity will go low. So different pesticides and chemicals are used to protect the crops. And what happens to these chemicals? This will definitely kill the pest. But at the same time, if after applying them, if it rains or if we carry out irrigation, these can be washed down into the soil, or some can be carried away into the water bodies. From the soil, so if it is reaching, if it is percolating into the soil, from the soil, this will be absorbed by the plants. Pesticides we had actually sprayed on the outer part of the plants. But from there, when it is reaching the soil, along with the other minerals or other nutrients and water, plants will absorb these chemicals from the soil. And it will get incorporated into their body. There is difference in the pesticides applied on the outer part of the plant body and those which are going into, inside, or in getting incorporated into their plant body. Along with water and minerals, these will be absorbed by the plants, and this will be taken up by other organisms. So take the case of terrestrial plants, plants which are growing on land. From the soil, plants will absorb it and incorporate it into the plant body. And you know that from plants, we all depend on plants for our food. So it will slowly, slowly move from one trophic level to another. And if you take the case of these chemicals being carried into water bodies, from the water body also, here I've given you an example of biomagnification taking place in the aquatic body, water body. But even terrestrial animals are also affected. Or aerial animals like the bird is also affected. Okay, and children, these chemicals, when washed down into the water bodies, from the water bodies, the plants and animals, or the small animals will absorb, from them bigger animals will absorb it, and they will keep moving from one trophic level to the other. They enter the food chain. They'll be entering the food chain. And when you go to the shop and buy some fruits and vegetables, after coming home, you will disinfect it by washing it in into water, lukewarm water, where you have added vinegar, or you can even prepare. But we even get disinfecting solutions for washing vegetables and fruits. It is available in different markets. So you soak them in all that, or in salt water you soak for some time. So different methods are there to sterilize them. But children, my question is, if these chemical substances are present, on the outer part of these fruits and vegetables, definitely we can remove it by washing. But just imagine, as a result of biological magnification or biomagnification, if these had entered into the organic matter, if they are incorporated into the content, will it be going by washing? Can we remove it by washing the outer part? Or even by cutting and washing also, it will not go. It has got incorporated. How much ever you wash, you cannot. Similarly, meat products. Meat products, you might wash it several times before cooking. But if the chemicals have entered into the body of these animals through the food chain, if it has got incorporated into the flesh, you cannot remove it by washing. The particles sticking externally, definitely you can remove. So that is the main danger. How much ever you try, you cannot. The only thing is stop using or reduce the usage of chemical substances for farming, and we have to depend mostly on organic farming. The farmers, they prefer, earlier they used to prefer the use of chemical pesticides or fertilizers or chemicals, because all these chemicals will give immediate results. Whereas when we go for something natural, completely organic, it might take time to give the result. But if you compare long-term and short-term benefits, short-term benefits are definitely for chemical substances. Immediately you will get better yield. But if you think about the long-term gains, fertilizers or chemical substances will not give you any benefit in the long run. Even the fertility of the soil will be low. Even though we call it by the name fertilizers, continuously if we use it for a long period of time, for several years, that can affect the fertility of the soil. The pH of the soil can change, and it can affect all the organisms, the plants as well as the other organisms, because they all are part of food chain. That is why nowadays we are all are encouraged to use or to carry out organic farming. We can carry out organic farming on a small scale at home also. Maybe some of you might be having vegetable garden at home. How many of you have like chili, tomato, then brinjal? Some of you are having, no? Not on a large scale, just to get the items that is required for cooking. Are many other, we're glad to see. So even I have at home, not on a large scale, like chili, tomato, then lemon. So a few things we too can grow at home. Then curry leaves. It is said that more than 16 pesticides are sprayed on this curry leaves. And how much ever you wash, it cannot be, so we cannot assure that, or we cannot make sure that you have made it or you have disinfected it. And curry leaves and all, you can easily grow at home. So that if you go for natural things, but we cannot completely avoid other, because many of everything we cannot produce at home. Some of the things, wherever possible, you can try out. And you too can help your mother, if your mother is or father is carrying out all these, you too can join in it, especially now. You have enough time, no? Just watering, just taking care of them in between. You will also get so much of happiness by taking care of these plants. How many of you are interested in growing plants or gardening? Not only plants that give us vegetables and fruits, even you can grow some flowering plants also. They also give us happiness.
And citrus plants.
Yes?
Citrus plants.
Citrus plants. What all citrus plants or citrus trees are there at home? Lemon, then?
Mango.
Mango is not citrus. Mango, then? Mango tree you have at home?
Yes, ma'am.
Now, plenty of mangoes are there. I think now it's the season for mangoes, no? Mangoes are there at home? Oh, if you were coming to school, I would have asked you to bring. Okay. So, children, Bhadra, Haya, Aman, Savio, Arjun, where are you? Where are you hiding? Yes. Hope you have understood the after effects or the side effects of using all these pesticides. So biomagnification is a very relevant topic. You should know, even if you wash it, even if you wash the vegetables and fruits many times with all the disinfectants, all the disinfecting solutions available, both natural or which you buy from hypermarkets, you won't be able to completely clear it off. Whatever particles or whatever chemicals are sticking onto the surface, definitely we will be able to remove, but not those which have got incorporated. So the only solution is try to reduce the use of all these chemical substances as far as possible. So here you can see the amount keeping on increasing, that red dots are shown to represent the concentration of chemicals. See how it is getting accumulated as it goes from one trophic level to the other. All these chemicals, as I told you, these are non-biodegradable. It's accumulation of non-biodegradable substances. So since these cannot be removed or these cannot be decomposed, their amount will get increased at each trophic level. As human beings occupy the top level in any food chain, maximum concentration will be found in our bodies. So actually we are the root cause and we are going to get affected the maximum by this biological magnification. So we have to be, it's high time that we have to take care of all these. In most of the food chains, we occupy the topmost level. As the level is, as the level of these harmful substances is getting increased as it passes from lower to lowest to highest trophic level, we will be affected mostly, or it will be accumulated maximum in our body. So we have to be very careful. It is due to biological magnification that our food grains, vegetables, fruits and even meat contain different amounts, varying amounts of pesticides which you cannot remove by any means. What you can remove is only those which are sticking to the surface of these substances. But that which has gone along with the water and other minerals into the plant body or into the body of animals cannot be removed by any means. Okay, children, so that was about biological magnification. In your textbook, it is not given under a separate heading, but that doesn't mean that it is a least important topic, very relevant topic. You can definitely expect questions and be thorough with this topic. Okay. Now we are going to learn about how do our activities affect the environment. It is mainly... Yes. Yes.
Can you show the last slide?
Oh, yes. Just a minute. It got stuck, I think. Okay. Just a minute, I'll show. This one, no? Is this the one? You want to see this one? Somebody please respond. Who wanted to see the slide?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, okay. Not, ma'am. Not it down. Please see that you read the textbook, okay? Whether you are writing down the lecture notes or you have the printed notes with you, but still reading textbook is must. And I came to know that some of you are not writing down the lecture notes, and we don't keep on saying this because you are grown up children, you're not in smaller classes, you know the importance of writing down the lecture notes, first of all to concentrate properly. We all are human beings, we get diverted in between, even I am not an exemption. So in order to maintain your concentration, if you write down the lecture notes, it will be of great help. That's why we insist you to write it down. And then you can take the help of the lecture notes, the notes which are sent in the group, and then the textbook. Definitely have to read the textbook. Don't simply depend on lecture note and the printed notes which you have. Definitely you should read the textbook. You should be familiar with each and every line in the textbook. And children, whenever you write lecture notes, see that you put the date and the topic. Otherwise, towards the end, when you have to prepare for the exam, you will find it very difficult to find out the topic. So see that you put the date, very, very important. I can ask you to show me the lecture notes. I think daily I will ask 2-3 to show me the lecture notes, okay? I'm going to do that because I came to know from your parents that some of you are not writing the lecture notes. With the date, I would like to see. If you want, you can put the date with a different color topic. So you try to make it interesting so that you will not get bored of writing. Some of you, I can see, they are simply sitting and listening. You might listen it and later, you after 10 minutes, you will forget. But if you are writing down, your memory retention will be better. you try to do for one day. It's going to help you so much. Can I change?
No.
Okay. All these points are there in the textbook.
In this chapter, biological magnification is not there.
Who said that? Melvin, you had asked me previous class also the same question. Yes, Melvin? And I told you the page.
Yes, sir.
You had asked me, I think, if my memory is correct. If I'm not wrong, you had asked me and I told you the page number also.
Yes, ma'am. I wrote it.
That's it. It is not given under a separate heading as a paragraph. And now I don't know the page number, but I think last day I told you. Okay, children. Now we'll move on to the next topic. How do our activities affect the environment? You know that human intervention is a main cause of pollution. It's because of our activities that our environment is getting polluted. And once the environment is polluted, we cannot survive. Without realizing that, we keep on with our activities, we are continuously damaging our environment. So due to that, you know, nowadays the temperature is fluctuating and it is becoming hot day by day. Am I right? Now it is raining, I know. But other than that, if you compare the maximum temperature that we get, it has increased when compared to previous years. It's all because of global warming, the pollution. You know, global warming is also the after effect of pollution. And you know about ozone layer also. No, ozone layer is getting depleted. That is also because of human activities. And you will be learning about ozone depletion in detail in this chapter. Our activities change the environment around us and the changes in our environment affect us. I think in physics there is a law, no? For every, what is that? Newton's third law of, what is that, children? Can anybody tell me? Have you learned? Every action is got an equal and opposite reaction. So if we are damaging the environment, definitely from the environment also we will get setbacks. We won't be able to survive in such an environment. So we have to make it, we have to preserve it in the pristine form, or we have to preserve it without getting polluted. Preserving doesn't mean that we should not make use of any resources. It's not that. We should make judicious use. But at the same time, we should not harm our environment. We should not pollute. We should satisfy, or we should be able to satisfy our requirements from the environmental resources, but see that we don't pollute it. Now here in this chapter, you are going to learn so many environmental problems are generated by human activities. But here we learn about just two of them. Just two of the activities we'll be learning. The first one, ozone depletion. Ozone depletion. And second one, waste disposal. Two major human activities with which the environment is getting polluted day by day. The quality of the environment is affected. If this continues like this for a long time, our earth won't be a better place for human beings to, not only human beings, the living organisms to survive. All the living organisms will get destroyed if the pollution goes on, if the rate of pollution goes on like this. So here we will see some of the precautionary measures or preventive measures that we can take. All these topics are included in your textbook because the young generation will become aware of the after effects and you will become more conscious. You will create awareness among others. That is why these such topics are included. So you should take it in the right sense, not only from the examination point of view, but you should develop an environmental awareness after reading or after learning chapters like this, because the present generation, the young generation has got a lot to do to improve the existing conditions. Okay. Now let's see in detail about ozone depletion and waste disposal. One of you tell me what is meant by ozone. What is meant by ozone, children? What have you understood? Maybe
atmospheric layer.
Wait a minute, Melvin. Let everyone turn their videos on. Only then I will continue. I'm ready to wait. Let them turn it on. Melvin, get ready. I'll give you the chance. Muhammad Aman, Afsana, Anjida, Savio, Nas. I didn't want to call out the names, but if you're not turning the videos on, I will have to. Quick. Savio, it had been long that I had seen you. Savio, are you hearing? Okay. Now, Melvin, continue.
Ozone is that atmospheric layer.
Are you reading from the textbook?
No.
Okay, good. Tell me. Ozone is the
atmospheric layer which protects us from ultraviolet rays.
Excellent. You have learned it in some other class, lower class? Yes?
This is everyone will know.
If you haven't learned, you know, it's a general thing. Okay. So we have. Or our earth surface is having a protective covering. You call it as ozone. And the main function of this ozone, actually ozone is a deadly poison. But ozone is present in the higher layers of the atmosphere. So when it is not in direct contact with the living organism and when this is present at higher layers of the atmosphere, they perform a very important function. That is protecting us from the harmful UV rays, ultraviolet radiation. So all the, you know, visible and invisible spectrum of sunlight you have learned in physics, all are not equally useful or equally useful. So some of them can be damaging, some of the radiations are harmful to us, and if regular exposure to these UV rays, or if we happen to get exposed to these UV rays on a regular basis, it can cause dangerous situations, dangerous diseases like skin cancer, cataract, and even not only human beings, it can affect other animals, plants, productivity of plants, all that can get affected. So it is very important that we have a ozone layer, a covering to protect us from these unwanted harmful radiations. But what is happening? Because of human activities, the ozone layer is getting depleted. We say ozone hole, but actually it is not hole, but the layer is getting thin. The thickness is getting reduced. It's not like a hole, but the layer is getting thinner and thinner because of human activities. And last year we read in newspaper that the situation is getting much better, and let's hope for the best, and we will see that, or we also will try out to reduce the emission of harmful substances that can lead to ozone depletion. One of the important chemical that causes ozone depletion, have you heard about it, children? Okay, anyways, we will learn. Ozone. Here you can see ozone, I have written it as O3. What does O3 means? Three atoms of?
Oxygen.
O3 is the molecule formed by three atoms of oxygen. Unlike oxygen, which is required, you know, O2 or oxygen, you can't even imagine a life without oxygen. Without oxygen, we will not be able to survive. Except a few anaerobic organisms, those do not require oxygen. But all the other living organisms, it's a prime requirement. Without oxygen, we won't be able to survive. Not even for a few minutes we can withstand without oxygen. And whereas ozone, oxygen is a lifesaver, whereas ozone is a deadly poison. But ozone is present in higher layers of the atmosphere. There they perform a very important function. It protects us from the harmful ultraviolet radiations. From where these radiations are emitted? From the sun. You know, solar energy is the ultimate source of energy. You know all that. But some part of the radiations are harmful. You want to see the slide once again? Previous one?
Yes, ma'am.
Ozone is a molecule formed by three atoms of oxygen. Oxygen is necessary for us to survive, O2. Whereas ozone is a deadly poison. But this deadly poison will not cause any harm because ozone is present at higher layers of the atmosphere. We are not coming in direct contact with this layer. And at higher layers or at higher levels, they perform a very important function. That is, it will protect sun from the sun's ultraviolet radiation. UV radiations emitted from the sun will be prevented from reaching the earth's surface with the help of ozone layer. So it protects us from the harmful ultraviolet radiations. Regular exposure to UV rays can cause several health hazards. Now let's see.
Ma'am, 1 minute. Can I show the last point?
Okay, okay, okay. Carry on, carry on. When you finish, when you complete, let me know. In the figure, you can see from the sun, UV rays reaching the earth, but it's not entering earth because of the protective layer that the earth has got. It is ozone layer. Okay? Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So before we proceed, we have another 8 minutes more left. So before we proceed, let me check whether you have understood whatever we have covered. Then I'll proceed. Surya, where are you? We started with biological magnification. Even though we had learned in the previous class, since it is a very important topic, I just want you to repeat the points that we learned already. Badra, 1 point. Badra? Badra, are you there? Aditya M, tell me about biological magnification.
It will the parts per million will increase with every trophic level. The harmful by a non-biodegradable.
Whenever you give that definition, no, as far as possible, use the same terms. But explanation, you can write in or you can say it in your own words. Okay. One more. Aman Shakir, why don't you try? Yes, Aman. Not clear, Aman. Speak to him.
The increase in concentration of harmful substances in the body of living organisms at successive levels of
reading, no, man. Rather than reading, I would love to hear you saying without checking anywhere, recollecting and saying. So I want you to learn as we are discussing all these. Try to at least 50%, if you have learned, it's more than enough. Then later onwards, you can revise and the points will be thorough. Aman, can you try once again? In between, you check, no problem. Today I'm giving you the excuse.
The increase in chemical substances in the body of living organisms at successive trophic levels.
Okay. And next time when I ask, you should not refer anywhere. Okay. Now, why it is that these chemicals cannot be washed away, or by washing, why we cannot remove these substances from grains, meat, vegetables, etc. Badra, what is the reason? Why can't we wash it? Now, so many disinfecting solutions are there. We can soak these up. Products in lukewarm water, adding salt, vinegar. So different methods, natural methods and other artificial methods are there. But why can't we remove all these chemicals? Why are we so much worried about biological magnification?
Because these chemicals are absorbed from the soil by the plants. So we cannot take.
It will be incorporated into their body. Whether they are absorbing it from water or from soil, these substances will get incorporated into its organic matter or into its body. So which you can't remove by washing it externally. And after that, what we learned? We learned about ozone layer. So tell me the list of the points that we learned about ozone layer. Johan? Any 1 point about ozone depletion? We didn't complete it, but what we have learned from that, you list out some points. What is ozone?
Ozone is the layer which protects the earth from ultraviolet rays.
Where are you looking?
Norma.
Okay, okay. So it protects us from harmful
radiation.
What radiation?
Ultraviolet radiation.
Ultraviolet radiations. Then what is ozone actually, Steve? What is ozone actually?
Molecules of atom.
Molecules of atom. Huh? What is the formula for that, Steve?
O3.
O3. That means from that you will get an idea. It's formed of?
Oxygen.
How many?
Atoms. 3 atoms.
Yeah, it is formed by combining 3 atoms of oxygen. And it is a deadly poison, but at higher levels of the atmosphere, they protect us from harmful ultraviolet radiations. Okay? Any doubts, children?
No, ma'am.
Surya? Surya is here? Surya? As soon as I took the attendance, you all went, children. Ah, Surya is here. Why don't you respond? Surya?
No, ma'am. When I only...
Yes, ma'am.
Surya, tell me, what is the important role performed by ozone layer? What is its role? Don't check anywhere. We had enough discussion. Tell me, what is the role of ozone layer? What is its role? Nirupama, you know the answer, Surya?
Ma'am, ozone layer protects us from harmful rays of sun.
Which radiations? Which one? Abbreviated form, at least you say. We have umbrellas also, no? Which is high, huh?
Oh.
Oh. You.
No, not that.
You have to say. Surya, I gave you the clue.
UV rays.
UV rays. Okay, thank you, children. See you next class.
Ma'am, seminar.